The first two ladies, did they get a round of applause?
Sure.
Anyway, I want to thank Wendy for her drive in the CDC and what she's doing in the city. We really appreciate your efforts. Wendy asked me to come up tonight and introduce our speaker to us today. And there's a reason behind that, and I'll explain that in just a minute. But how many of you currently live in Beaver Falls? Okay, interesting. It's always good to start with questions. If you're nervous, it calms you down. You can ask the question and see folks raise their hand. How many of you do not live in Beaver Falls? I'm really nervous, I wanna. And how about you folks, second to last row, are you Geneva College students? Are you really?
Yeah.
In Mr. Fry's class?
Yeah.
Really? Okay, good. Well, welcome to the presentation tonight. We hope you certainly enjoy it. I would like to go on record to say that I thoroughly enjoyed the series last year, all three presentations. The mayor did a fantastic job in speaking about our city. We love our city. I retired a couple years ago and someone said, where are you moving to? And I said, oh man, I would not move from here. I love Beaver Falls. I love living here. I live up on College Hill. I have great neighbors. I really do. I've got some great neighbors and in the community. Over the years that I've been here, I couldn't have asked for a better place to live. We have some issues, but every place has issues. We have a great little place, and I would it would behoove each of you youngins to consider moving into this place and making a difference in the lives of those around you. My father was born and raised in Beaver Falls, graduated in 1938 from Beaver Falls High School, and passed away in 2000, January or February of 2000. And he just loved Beaver Falls. Right before World War II, he got married and then moved to Monaca because that's where my mother was living. And so he wanted to live with her. In marriage, of course. And so that's where I'm from originally. But in 1999, they hired me here at Beaver Falls to be their high school principal. And September of 99 is when I started. And my father was tickled pink. His picture is even in the 1938 picture. All the teams, they have all the teams all the way back to about 1920-something. And my daddy is in that picture. A lot thinner than I am currently, but I'm told that we look alike. I don't see it, but that's what he said. So in 1999, I became the principal of Beaver Falls High School, and just loved it. Nine of the most challenging years of my life, but nine of the most rewarding. I went through 99 to 2000, and then in the year 2000, a new freshman class came over, and in that class was Rocky Washington. He was a ninth grader. I watched him for 4 years, and I'm not known for a whole lot of things that I did at Beaver Falls High School, but I did do this, and this is what the kids always remember. At the end of the year, I would put a poem together because I could never remember what my high school principal said at commencement, and I bet most of you can't either. So I thought, you know what? I'm gonna put a poem together and mention every single kid in the senior class. And it rhymed. Now listen, trust me, wasn't Shakespeare, okay? Was a little bit of roses are red, violets are blue, that kind of stuff, you know what I mean? But it all rhymed. And here's a fascinating thing. I'm gonna read a little portion of it to you from the class of 2004, which is what Rocky was in. In fact, I mentioned him last, and I usually saved the best for last. And I still have a copy of that poem. And the interesting thing is, Rocky graduated that year, and so did Deanna, his wife, Deanna Slapp. He's sitting right to Rocky's left. And also in that class was Tonette Whitted, who's seated in the second row. And her good friend and mine, Sauna Clark, who has to work tonight, couldn't be here. But I gotta tell you, it gives me such pleasure with Sauna and Rocky and Tonette. Tonette started a group in Beaver Falls called My Brother's Keeper, and they invited their high school principal to serve on the board. It's a mentoring program for children in Beaver Falls, and and the surrounding communities. So proud of those kids that stay in the city and make a change in people's lives. But here's what I wrote. Here was the opening to that poem. I started a tradition of giving my speech in rhyme, but I keep telling those who ask, I'm not doing this every time. It was pretty difficult to do, to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
But every year, some seniors say, are you going to do that poem? Then I give in and get to work, and here is how I know him. Here's what I said about Tonette. Wendy Seaman, trombone solo, would have made her father proud. He had passed away. Tonette witted, Bible club. At lunch, a little loud. Right, Tonette? And then Sauna, Sanders was a quiet guy. From NHS, he won money. Sauna Clark was queen of the prom. She was always funny. If she was here, you'd see that.
Yeah.
And then I wrapped this up with Allison Channels will work with kids. In the school store, she did sell. Rocky Washington led in honors courses and other ways as well. I want you to know that, I don't know how I did it, but I hit the nail on the head. Rocky Washington was a leader. He took a lot of honors courses, but he was a leader in being honorable. 4 years, I watched this young man. He was one of the finest students I ever came across in my 31 years in public education. Rocky is a graduate, most importantly of Beaver Falls High School, but also Robert Morris University, and he has his master's degree from Jackson State in Mississippi. Ladies and gentlemen, Rocky Washington.
Good evening. Man, that was, I gotta say, that was a heck of an introduction. I don't think I could have gotten anybody else better to say that. But as you know, Mr. Karczewski, he was my principal during the high school years. And I gotta say, from a student to a former principal, he did a heck of a job. And he's actually one of the reasons why I'm up here tonight, because he was part of what shaped me. So tonight, that's exactly what I'm gonna be speaking about. Wendy had approached me at a dinner that our organization put together, My Brother's Keeper, in February. And when she approached me, she asked, you know, to do this, and say, so I said, well, what's the subject going to be? How Beaver Falls shaped me. Wow. What a question. So I said, you know, I have to tackle that question. Because a question like that, not only do you have to search here, but you really got to do a lot of searching right here, because you have to search deep down and find out, how does this shape me? So Mr. Karczewski, when he first came up, he asked a question, you know, how many people are actually from Beaver Falls? I saw a lot of hands get raised. How many people are not living in Beaver Falls? I saw a few. I'm glad that we have that diversified group. You know, it's good that other people are coming here to listen to what we have to say in this speaker series. I want to say that this question that's been posed to me is very personal. You know, it's something, like I said, not only am I searching my mind, but I'm searching my heart as well. So the experiences that I speak about tonight are coming from, I'm 30 years old, I'm an African-American male in Western Pennsylvania in the town of Beaver Falls. That's the experience that you're gonna get. Then you have other speakers that are following me. You'll notice that everybody's gonna have a different type of experience, a different shape, a different way that they may have seen. We could have been in the same place at the same time. We could have seen the same thing. But maybe that person interpreted it different. Maybe that event or whatever was said had a different effect on that person and shaped them differently. So it's interesting to know and to hear other people's perspective on things. So with that being said, I'll go ahead and begin. Oh, first I want to back up for 1 second, just kind of give an introduction, just to elaborate on the great job Mr. Karczewski did. I live on College Hill, 415 40th Street. I live with my wife, Deanna, my son, Rocky. I have another baby on the way. We don't know what it is yet. We find out Friday. And I got to admit, that's a surprise waiting on me. But like Mr. Karczewski said, I'm a graduate of Beaver Falls High School. I went on to get my business of finance degree at Robert Morris. And then from there, I got my master's degree in business from Jackson State University. I haven't lived in Beaver Falls my whole life. I grew up here, but I traveled due to college, due to work. I've went to Penn State. I've been to Baltimore. I've lived in Texas. I've lived in Johnstown. So with that being said, I have a good opportunity to see what Beaver Falls is like before I left, what it was when I came back, but more importantly, kind of how we compare to other places. You know, it's easy to just talk bad about a place or talk great about a place, but when you've never been anywhere else, how does that compare? What does it all mean? So for me, to be able to travel and live in those places and to meet new people and kind of get an understanding and learn about their walks of life, it put mine in perspective. So, how Beaver Falls shaped me. There are four different categories that I'm going to talk about today on how Beaver Falls shaped me. One, education. Two, economics or the economy. Three, community. And four, race. So let's start off with the education aspect. Beaver Falls has two different types of education. One being the traditional math, sciences, you know, social studies, things like that. But it also has another education, one a little bit more unique to our Beaver County counterpart school districts. It has a unique social education. So I'll break down the two. Let's talk about the first education, the math, and things like that. Going through school, I started at South Elementary School. I don't know if you guys are familiar with South Elementary, but I think now it's some type of home, or I can't remember, but it's not a school anymore. Let's put it that way. The playground is still there. I drive by it, and boy, the memories come up on the playground. I remember I was on the monkey bars, and you know, it's like an ant almost, like a monkey bars ant. And we used to have, back in the day, I'm only 30 years old. But let's say in the 90s, for some that's old, for others it's like, oh, that was yesterday, you know? But we used to watch on TV the American Gladiators. And we used to have gladiator competitions on that. And what it is one kid hung from one side, the other kid hung on the other, and you had to like wrap your legs around the other person, try to drag them down. You know, and I remember the one time I was on there, and I was actually versing a girl. And she wrapped her legs around me and drug me down. I hit my head, hit my chin right off the bar, and oh, boy, did it hurt. But I remember those experiences, South School. Looking back on it, I had teachers like Mrs. Brown, Mrs. Chancellor, Mrs. Rollins, Mrs. Pisano, who's now Mrs. Hawthorne. And that was my first through fourth grade teachers. I remember them well. The education that they brought me was right on par. We went through the, you know, adding and subtracting. By the time I reached fourth grade, I was multiplication, division, long division, algebra, all of those things. Science as well. history, Mrs. Rollins, I remember Mrs. Rollins' fourth grade history class, you know, social studies we called it. You know, we were learning about the Native Americans and wigwams and longhouses and how it pertained to, you know, Western Pennsylvania. Then I came to the middle school. The middle school was unique because, again, I'll use the term back in the day. Back in the day, we had a lot more elementary schools. There was South School, there was Central School, there was Cobble Elementary School, there was Big Beaver Elementary School. And am I missing anything else? Did I say Central School? So when you got to the middle school, that was when everybody kind of came together. You know, so a lot of the people that went to the other schools, now you met. And that's where I met people like Toadette. She was in my fifth grade class. We actually did a play together one time. And I believe it's still on. It was recorded. And if we wanted to pull that tape up, I'm pretty sure we could. But we had Mr. Taylor. And that was quite an experience. I remember going through middle school, and we were doing things in science class, like dissecting owl pellets. You know, we were looking at worms and all different kinds of things. You know, I remember in eighth grade, we got to Mr. Badacki's class, chemistry class, and we were, you know, had Bunsen burners going. We were mixing in chemicals and hydrochloric acid and shooting rockets and all of these certain things, you know, these great things that we had. And so a lot of people, you know, they look back at Beaver Falls Elementary School, middle school, and they frown upon that. And they say, they don't have a good education system down there. Not compared to ours. We're from Monaca. We're from Center Township. We're from Beaver. We're from Blackhawk. They can't match us. But what's the truth behind that? The truth is we had just as great, if not better, education than what they had. They just didn't know it. Right?
Yes.
So then we got to high school. And in high school, it started out excellent. I remember my ninth grade math class was geometry. I remember my science class was lab science with, I can't remember what's her name. Oh, I can't.
Miss Clark.
No, it wasn't Miss Clark. It was, I can't remember.
Miss Cawdy.
Cawdy. There you go. Mrs. Cawdy. One of my favorites. We were doing a lot of things. You know, we were looking at planets. We were looking at, like I said, dissecting frogs. I remember we cut open a frog and it had eggs and all kinds of things that spilled out of it. I mentioned in science a lot because when I was younger, I was really interested in science. You know, I wanted to be this either scientist or some type of surgeon or something like that. I didn't know I was going to grow up to be a businessman. But we did things like that. And then something came called the No Child Left Behind. And they incorporated PSSAs and testing. And so the next year, well, everybody's looking forward to it. Let's dissect frogs. Oh, I can't wait. I want to sign up for this class. I mean, this isn't just, you know, the nerds per se. This is a lot of people that are interested in this stuff. They want to learn. They're very fascinated with this. But then they said, well, we're not doing that anymore. Why? How come? I'm interested. I want to learn. Because the test. Well, what's the test? What's this PSSA test that came? What do you mean? Well, we can't do that class anymore. Or we can't, not the class, but we can't do stuff like that anymore because we need to make sure that what you're learning is going to allow us to have good enough scores on this test. So that way we can have, you know, nobody looks at our school as a bad school and the state doesn't come and take it over. Think to yourself, what? I really like that class. I really like doing stuff like that. How come we can't just continue to do that? Sorry, guys, we can't do it anymore. But even though we had things like that that we faced, you know, we still pressed on at Beaver Falls. You know, there was other classes that we took, Spanish, French. We had clubs, bio club. We had ski club, you know, we had FBLA club. I mean, on and on and on, National Honor Society. And Beaver Falls found a way to press through it, right? Our test scores, some years, yeah, it may not have been the best. But just when you thought Beaver Falls was down, we would come roaring back. That class would prove to other people, or that class, you know, that class of 2004, I'm in 2004, we would prove to other people that we are smart, you know, that we do care about education. And when I look back at all these things that happened, you know, I can honestly say, when I graduated, Mr. Cartesi said, you know, honors class, I took a lot of honors classes. I took calculus, I took physics, I took college prep English, I took biochemistry. This is all my senior year, by the way. And I really was fascinated with all of those classes. I wanted to learn. And Beaver Falls fed my hunger to learn. There's some schools that can't do that, especially from what I hear sometimes today. They're, with budget cuts and whatnot, they're not able to do it. I was in the highest Spanish class that I could get. I think it was Spanish 5 or AP Spanish. Beaver Falls was there for me. When I wanted something, Beaver Falls was there for me. There was an unfortunate time that we had when I was in school. 2002, World Trade Center's come down. I was in Spanish class when it happened. And I think all of us, because that time was so unique and so great, those of us who was able to live through it and remember it, it's something that you'll never forget. And we just brought this up the other day. Mr. Karczewski, he actually called everybody, so he got on the speaker, you know, everybody turn on the TVs, we're under attack. And, you know, everybody's worried. We see planes hit the towers. You know, then soon after we hear about planes hitting the Pentagon. And then soon after that we hear about another plane going down to Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Wow, that really hit home, Pennsylvania. What are we gonna do? We never experienced anything like this. Mr. Karczewski gathered the willing students together and he said, let's pray. Now today's age, I don't know how acceptable that is today. And I don't know how acceptable it was back then. But for this man, somebody who's a principal, the head of the school, to care that much about his students, and he saw the fear in our eyes that day, to say, you know what? I know what the rules are, but I know what the right thing is to do. And we did. We did. That's the type of education that I got at Beaver Falls. May not be what the rules say, but I know what the right thing is to do, and I'm gonna do it. So let's talk about the social aspect. Like I said, it's very unique, because when you look around the area, you have schools like New Brighton, you have schools like Blackhawk, you have schools like Beaver, Center Township. They don't have the same social education that we have. In Beaver Falls, you have a mixed diversity of people. From all walks of life, you have black people, white people, poor people, middle class people, upper middle class people. It teaches you, when you have that type of diversity, it really teaches you that people are okay. Just because somebody's not from the same walk of life that you're from, that doesn't mean that you gotta be scared of them because you don't understand them. Because maybe they may come to school with dirty shoes on and you got a nice clean pair of Nikes, you know, because they may wear the same shirt maybe for a couple days in a row and you got a nice fresh shirt on. You know, you don't have to make fun of them or, you know, be afraid of them. Maybe because somebody's just lagging behind. Maybe because somebody's a little hungrier at lunch. So they might eat a little bit more than you. They might ask you for your bread. They might ask you for an extra milk. You know, that's the type of stuff that you get at Beaver Falls that you might not get anywhere else. You know, we have the tendency to look at other people and see, because they're not like us, we reject them and we cast stereotypes on them. At Beaver Falls, you're forced to confront that stereotype. So when somebody says, or when you hear from an outside area, oh, that those types of people, you know, they're no good, you can say, well, hold on, wait a minute. This guy that sits in my class, he's great. He's one of my best friends. I talk to him every day. You know, and the other day I needed a pencil, and guess who had an extra one? He was more than willing to give it to me. You know, that's an education that is beyond, you know, school books. It's not scored by a standardized test. You can't get an A in it. You can't get a B in it. You know, but it's something that is taught at Beaver Falls. And like I said, if you look at the surrounding areas, many of the surrounding areas in the school districts are divided by either social class, right? Mainly social class, and race. So when you look at other areas where everybody comes from the same social class, everybody looks just alike, what kind of education are you getting? How are you preparing yourself to really go into the real world? What is the real world? Is the real world everybody that looks just like you, that comes from the same place as you? Or is the real world a mix of different people that look differently, that talk differently, that like different things? One might like cricket and soccer. Another one might like basketball and football. But you know what? We got to learn to respect what the other person calls fun or what they call good. You get that education at Beaver Falls. I received that education at Beaver Falls. Not many people can say that. Now I'm going to move on to economy, economics. This is a tough one. Like I said, I'm 30 years old. I was born in 1985. And something dramatic happened in the 80s to Beaver Falls. Not just Beaver Falls, but to the United States. But we really felt it hard in Beaver Falls. And that's outsourcing. So in the 1980s, for those of you who aren't from around here, the steel industry was our bread and butter. Okay, when outsourcing really came into play, those jobs that we once had, those steel businesses that really made Beaver Falls, they left. B&W. Like I said, I live at 415 40th Street. If you knew where I lived, you would know that every day that I wake up and I come outside, I'm staring pretty much into the past. B&W sits right across the street from me, and I can see it for what's left of it anyway, in clear view. It's a every single day reminder of what Beaver Falls once was, what it currently is, but also what it could be. So, like I said, back in the 80s, that was the thing, outsourcing. The steel town left. And with that, a lot of jobs left. And with a lot of jobs, a lot of people left. When a lot of people left, boy, what was here? What stayed? You saw through the 80s, through the 90s, 2000s, a steady decline of Beaver Falls. I think it can be summed up the most by the wave pool. You know, when you come in, unfortunately, when you come in right off the turnpike, if you're somebody that's new or has never been to Beaver Falls, say you made a wrong turn or, you know, you need to get gas, that's one of the first things you see when you come into Beaver Falls. And I don't know about you, but I've been told and I've experienced that the first impression means a lot and it can go a long way. So when our first impression is a wave pool that looks like it belongs in a Resident Evil movie or The Walking Dead, You know, it really says, well, hold on, am I really entering the town of the walking dead? And they get afraid. They do. They get afraid. Now, when I see that wave pool, automatically a flood of memories come back. I grew up right down the street from that wave pool. I would go to that wave pool as much as I possibly could. I learned to swim at that wave pool. And how I learned to swim is from a woman named Skip Baker. For those of you who know Skip, Skip was great. She was something else, right? And how I passed my swimming test was I stood at the deep end, Skip was behind me, and she just pushed me in. And she always had a towel with her, a long towel. So if you couldn't swim, she'd throw the towel down into the water, and she'd tell you to grab the towel, and she'd pull you up, right? And mind you, Skip was small, you know, she was a little small lady. But man, she was something else. Skip needs like her own. When I walk through this museum, she needs a picture somewhere along in there, because she is part of this community. And that's my memories of the wave pool. So when I see the wave pool in its present state, and kind of the picture, the aura, the mood that it sets is nothing like what I know in my mind that it was, what this city was, what this city is, and what this city can be. And that's just one of the things. You know, when you go through downtown, the downtown area, I mean, there's some buildings that are torn down. You know, there's abandoned buildings. There's buildings that are just sitting there. They've been sitting there in the same state for years, and no for sale sign on them. Nobody knows what's going to happen to them. You know, people see that. Beaver Falls sees that. And I kind of compare it. There's a saying that I have. So as us here in Beaver Falls, sometimes we get so used to that. You know, we look at it, we're saying, oh, it's not that bad. We don't even see it really. You know, it's just something that becomes subconscious to us. It embodies Beaver Falls. We say, oh, well, that's Beaver Falls right here. This is what you see is Beaver Falls. But to the outsider, they come in and see it. And once again, the same effect as the wave pool. Oh my gosh, this doesn't look like a very nice place. And we're saying, oh, it's not that bad. I don't really see anything. Really, I don't know what you're talking about. You know, it's kind of like when you go to a farm, right? A mile before you hit that farm, let's say if it's a cow farm, pig farm, oh my gosh, what is that smell? It's terrible. But when you get up there and you ask that farmer, do you smell that? I don't smell anything. It's you. That's kind of how it is. You get used to it. And so you kind of get, you don't see a need sometimes to make something better. Because you get used to it. That's how you're programmed. But on the flip side, although you see these buildings like I described, although the wave pool looks like it is, it's still looked at for somebody like me, for somebody like you, as an opportunity. Wendy mentioned earlier that she was given this Tribune building. And that really made me happy, because that Tribune building is one that I've always looked at and said, you know what, that building, look how great it used to be. If somebody were to take that building and make it better, it doesn't have to go to what it used to be. It just doesn't have to be how it currently is. If somebody could make it better, boy, would that look good. And I'm very happy to know that you guys now have obtained that building and you have plans for it. That's just the beginning. So right when you think, and right when I think that, oh man, Beaver Falls is getting a little, I don't know, man. All these new businesses start springing up. My cousin Marco, he owns a barber shop. It's called the Chop Shop. Nice place. Great place for a conversation. I encourage you, if you want a good conversation, you go there. Okay, you'll get a great conversation. You have people at the down end of town, past Mr. Jackson's barber shop, that has pottery places, and you have, is that you? Oh man, it's beautiful. You just, and the funny part, like, I never even knew it was there until all of a sudden I dropped, like, wow, that's a nice place. Very nice. You know, you have the this and that store over here. You know, you have just a collection of things. The chicken shack, yeah. That way, yeah, that way. D&G is still there. Now we have a very interesting brewery, you know, that popped up.
Hutch and Home.
There you go. Yeah.
Vintage Reborn.
Vintage, exactly. Karen's old place, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See? So you do have hope. There's things here that you can't just say. I could rag on for 3 hours about the bad. But guess what? I can also rag on for 10 about the good.
Yeah.
Right? We can't get caught up as people from Beaver Falls what the outside perception is. Yes, you can use it as a comparison, but don't let it define who we are, because we're more than that.
Yep.
We're way more than that.
Yep.
And economics is something that a lot of people, it's obviously measured by materials, but a lot of times, even though something may not look good on the outside, mm-hmm. there's a lot of spirit within that, mm-hmm. within that building. Mm-hmm. So although that building may not look the best, the people that own it, that's Beaver Falls. So we have these staples. We have Orm's Donuts. You know, we have D&G. We have the hot dog shop. I'll say Jay's News.
I'm sorry, I like it.
That's another topic.
Got Wolf's, got Enlow's, got Athens, all kinds of places.
We do. Wolf's, Enlow's, Athens, all these staples. I mean, these are stores that would compete with the best of the stores.
Yeah.
But not many people know about them. Not many people want to go there. And there are things that have contributed to its decline. So before, I mentioned the steel industry and leaving. But there are also some key factors that we have to deal with even today, and when we think about how we're going to move forward, okay? Because I'm here today giving you how Beaver Falls shaped me thus far, but I'm going to give you guys a question back to say, how has Beaver Falls shaped you thus far, but more importantly, how will it shape you in the future?
Yeah.
And that's something that we need to think about. So on that note, when we look at the Beaver Falls future, okay, and the things that have impacted us in the past, we need to figure out how we're going to overcome these obstacles. One of the biggest obstacles, and I don't know how many people have thought of this, is 376. Has anybody ever thought about 376 being an obstacle?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's a great road, goes straight to Pittsburgh. You know, goes straight from Ohio right to Pittsburgh. But let me give you the background for those of you who aren't familiar with this area or who may be a little younger. When you have Route 18, Route 18 runs right through Beaver Falls, and it turns into 7th Avenue, and that turns into 65, and then that turns into the Ohio River Boulevard, and that takes you right into Pittsburgh. Before 376 came about, you had... If you wanted to go from the west to the east and from the east to the west, you had to go down 7th Avenue. You had to come through this place. You had to see the businesses that were erected. You had to see the people that walked the streets, and not in a bad way, okay? You had to be confronted by this area that could break down some of those barriers that now stand in their way today. That we spoke about as being, as Beaver Falls people, those barriers are confronted every day with us, and we're able to overcome them. But these people, but other people that aren't from around here, or that aren't from here, those barriers are still erected. And they can avoid Beaver Falls every single day. There is no reason for them to come through here unless they absolutely have to. There's no reason for them to come to Beaver Falls unless it's for a specific reason. But other places, let's say like Cranberry, for instance. Everybody loves Cranberry. What makes Cranberry so great? How did Cranberry become what it is? People had to go through it. When you cross over into 279 Turnpike, you have to go by there, okay? And businesses sprung up from that. So you had the combination of 376, you had the steel mills leaving, and then there's one other thing. You had the malls, right? So the mall came up, and it wasn't in Beaver Falls. It's away from Beaver Falls in the middle of Beaver County. But now, why do I need to come to Beaver Falls? Why? Do I got to come here and get some shoes from Enloe Shoes? Or do I just go to Foot Action at the mall where there's four different, you know, shoe stores? Where there's, you know, a food court, you know? It's a city amongst itself. Those three things really decimated Beaver Falls. And Beaver Falls is a place of small business. It thrives on small business. It was made for small business. But we're continually competed with these huge franchises like Walmart and Home Depot and Giant Eagle. We used to have the food land down here. I used to live down at my grandma's house on 807th Street. Okay, it was maybe a block away from food land. We used to go to the food land all the time. That's gone. There's another store that's there, Save-A-Lot, but even before that came, sometimes we struggle to have a grocery store in Beaver Falls. Mm-hmm. A-Plus is gone. Do you know we only have one gas station in the entire city, and it happens to be all the way up on this side? Why do I gotta come to Beaver Falls if I'm not from here? Why? I don't have a reason to, so you know what? I'm just gonna keep on going right by that exit, and I'll go someplace else. That's what we face. Now, different things have come up in recent years between shale, you know, and other industries that we're trying to hold on to. They're in Beaver County. Not so much in Beaver Falls, but in Beaver County. So when you look at places like Beaver, right? How come they survived the outsourcing? How come they didn't end up like Beaver Falls? How come you can walk down the street in Beaver right now and just feel like you're in Swickley? Seriously, you can't. What are they benefiting from? And they look down on Beaver Falls and say, well, you guys should have pulled up your bootstraps. You know, you guys should have worked harder. You know, you should have did better. But is what separates them from us? They... not lucked out, but they were blessed with two very solid and stable industries that pull in a lot of cash. What's that?
No, I just was saying it's the county seat, so
yeah.
Going.
So they have the big courthouse there, big nice courthouse where lawyers and judges and everybody like that goes to have their work. So, you know, when they get out, they're walking around on the streets with, you know, $250,000, $300,000 paychecks. They also have the medical center filled with doctors, nurses. And the medical center, everybody gets hurt. That's not going anywhere. You need that. You need the justice building. You need the courthouse. Everybody, every now and again, they get in trouble. That's always going to be there. Eventually, something will come. I don't know what, but we got to just hold on for a little while longer. Every time I think that we've reached the bottom, you know, and there's no hope, there's no way up, we somehow find it. You know, just like I said previously, just when you thought we were down, here we come. You know, in sports, we could be down by 50 points and we'll never, ever give up until the end. The city has to be the same way. Mm-hmm. We cannot give up, okay? And so that brings me to my next topic, community. This community, like I said previously, is being judged as a book, okay? They look at our cover and they say, oh my gosh, that cover is worn, it's torn, it's got dust all over it, looks like people kicked it around. But when they get a chance to open that book and they can really read the contents of its pages, and they can see, wow, what a great story. That's the people, and that's the city of Beaver Falls. That great story. People that have to face adversity every single day, and yet never quit. People that hold on to hope every single day. Sometimes it may not come right away, but they hold on to that hope. They hold on to that dream. In this community, I'm chairman of my brother's keeper. Okay? Tonette's the executive director. We're a mentorship organization. Mr. Karczewski and his wife are mentors. Miss Johnetta, she's a board member. And there's other board members as well. Us and other organizations like us have banded together to just try to lift this community. The CDC that we learned about today, to lift the community. Hope is here. I've never been to another community where somebody as a whole, the community as a whole has been kicked so much. And then just when you're down, it seems like somebody's always trying to kick you an extra time. Somebody's always trying to put a fork in you. But we as a community, we have stood together and we refuse, and I mean refuse, to give up. If we can look at the federal government or the state government or the county government and say, you know what? You don't even have to help us, because we'll help ourselves. Mm-hmm. We'll take it amongst ourselves. If you don't help us, we don't need help from other people. We'll go ahead and do it ourselves. That's the type of people that are here in Beaver Falls. You may not get that somewhere else. Like I said, go to Center Township. See how many organizations like that they have. I don't know. Do you know?
None.
In Beaver Falls, I've learned we have a homeless shelter. You know, we have these the church organizations that help people. We have the community watch. Not because the community is bad all the time. But you know what? It's good to walk around. Show your face. Mm-hmm. How you doing? Can I help you out? Mm-hmm. Let me serve you in the best way that I can. Once again, that's what Beaver Falls has taught me. When we formed My Brother's Keeper, one of the biggest questions that we ask ourselves, but to our mentors and our mentees, what is success? What does success mean to you? What does it mean to you? From other communities, they might say, well, you know what? Success is I have a Bentley out front, or you know, I have a 5-bedroom, 5-bathroom house. I have on a Versace suit. I wear the best cologne. I have the best shoes. You see these shoes here? These shoes are $200. Yes, I'm successful. Okay. Maybe. Why is success in your eyes defined by material gain? So tell me your definition of success. My definition of success is, how well did I put myself in a position that I may serve somebody else the best that I can. That's my idea of success. If I can put myself in a position to help somebody else or to serve somebody else, not myself, I'm successful. And the moment that I stop seeking to serve is the moment that I'm unsuccessful. Even if it's the basics to serve my family, to serve as a father, to serve as a husband, as a brother, as a son, that's success. When you lose sight of that, you're dead. And that's what makes me know that Beaver Falls is not dead. We're still alive. Our spirit is alive and well because we're willing to look at each other and say, you know what? I see that you're struggling, and I'm willing to help you out. I'm willing to help you out. That right there is success. That right there is the Beaver Falls community. A soulful community. A community that's alive, that's bright, and that shines. In my opinion, we shine the light so that other communities can see what we do and copy what we do. Because when it's their turn, not everybody sits on the throne long. Okay? You don't sit on that throne forever. And when it's your turn to get off of that throne, I want you, in the face of diversity, to look back and say, I'm still willing to help others. I'm still willing to serve you. That right there is how you measure somebody's soul. And I know Beaver Falls has soul. But we don't know if those other communities have soul or not, because they've never been faced with the adversity that we've been faced with. So lastly, and this might be the topic that could be tense, I don't know, is race. A lot of people have different perspectives on this stuff. But once again, I'll just say that this is my perspective. This is my experiences. I'm not up here to lie to you. I'm not up here to sugarcoat things. Beaver Falls is a place where, like I said, we get challenges, we get hurdles, and we get barriers, and we're forced to overcome those barriers. So what I say is it's exactly how I feel, and it goes into how Beaver Falls has shaped me. So when it comes to race, there's two sides of the coin. There's the good and there's the bad, the yin and the yang. Okay? So I first want to start off with, I don't want to leave on anything bad. Okay? I don't want to leave on anything like that. I want to leave on a positive note. So I'll start off with some of the not so good, and I'll call them challenging experiences that have shaped me. And then I'll move into the more positive light of things that have shaped me. So Beaver Falls is a place where it is defined by race. It is what separates us, for however you want to think about it, it's what separates us from the next community. We have a higher diversity than the other communities, primarily African American. Okay? Being in Beaver Falls, and this isn't just in Beaver Falls, it's in Western Pennsylvania. But once again, I used to live in Texas, Fort Worth, Texas, a place of cowboys, a place that was once part of the Confederacy, and a place that is extremely proud of once being their own country. I cheered every single day, and it irritated me to no end. When I moved back from Texas, I saw more Confederate flags here than I saw in Texas, a place that used to be a part of the Confederacy. And I don't know what your thoughts are on the Confederate flag, but from an African American standpoint, the Confederate flag to us is the same as the Nazi flag to a Jewish person. Mm-hmm. It really cuts to our souls because we have a unique history in the world and in within the United States, and we're still in searching mode to find ourselves. We're still trying to find how we fit in to this country and how we're going to move forward. And when we see the Confederate flag, it hurts. I'll just be honest. It hurts. I remember my dad was walking on 7th Avenue to his car, and a pickup truck drove by, had a big Confederate flag across the back window, and shouted to him, "You nigger!" Just kept going. Now, some people may think, that's Beaver Falls, that's Western Pennsylvania, just ignore it. But that type of stuff hurts. That's intimidation. That's just basically saying, we don't want you here. And this is people that have called this place home. I remember growing up in high school, you know, I was a baseball player more than anything. I went to school, I went to college to play football. I played at Penn State University. I was a cornerback. But through high school, I had 4 years on the baseball team. My last 2 years, I was the only African American on the team. The only one in Beaver County.
Oh my gosh.
They did an article, the Beaver County Times did an article on me. They did. I was the only one. With the exception of like Summit Academy. But as far as a normal school, why? We have athletes. Basketball. Look at our basketball team. Look at our football team. Our football team is a prime example. Black, white, coming together for a common cause. And I can honestly say that those people that I played with throughout the years, there's no distinction. I mean, they're like family. There's no color to be seen. But why? Why? Beaver Falls, I went to All-Star games. I was the first one to go to an All-Star game from Beaver Falls in maybe 10 years since they won the title in 94. It was 2004. I was the fastest person, baseball player, in Western Pennsylvania at the time. I had, for those of you who don't know baseball, I'm sorry, but I had a 530 batting average, okay? I was, I think, one or two home runs away from leading the Whippule in home runs. I hit 14 home runs in my junior and senior year. Letters, everything. And I didn't get one phone call from anybody in college.
Wow.
Not one. Not a letter, not a phone call.
Wow.
And then I go and play a half a year of football my senior year. A half a year because I got injured. I broke my ankle. And I got a full scholarship offer to go to Cheney University, which is a historically black university. Why the difference? Why do African Americans in Western Pennsylvania not get that chance? Why are we so turned off that we no longer wish to participate? These are the types of things that we have. I remember going through a store, okay? I won't say which store, but I remember going into the store, and I was with my cousins, I was with my aunt, and one of us was walking around the store with our hands in our pockets. And when we went to go leave, the person that owned the store stopped us and said, "I know you stole something." "What do you mean?" "Well, you had your hands in your pockets." Mind you, we're the only black people in there. What do you mean? Empty your pockets right now, and then go and get the sheriff that's sitting over there. Empty our pockets, there's nothing. Why? Why? I'm just as part of this community as anybody else. I want to help this community like other people. And then, there's the education aspect. And this is what I wish, looking back on it. So once again, I had a great education. But because Beaver Falls is unique, and we have a higher than normal African American population, it's very important in the schools that we teach African American heritage and history. Think about this for a second. As an African American, I go to school. And I learn about Columbus and how great of a man he was and how he was the founder of America, how we have Columbus Day after him. And he was this great man. I remember they taught us a song. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. He sailed and sailed and sailed and sailed to find this land for me and you. But let's take a look at what Columbus really was. Does anybody know the history of Christopher Columbus?
Yes.
If you did, you would ask yourself, why in the heck are we celebrating this man as a holiday?
Yes.
He was despicable.
Yep.
But we learn as African Americans to celebrate that, right? We learn about Plato and Aristotle. We learn about the Dark Ages and how when Rome fell, pretty much the entire world stopped turning.
Yeah.
And it was the Dark Ages. We didn't learn about what was going on in Africa and great empires like Carthage, where Hannibal was from, like Mansa Musa, who was so rich in gold, he broke the currency system in Egypt. We didn't learn about the Egyptian pharaohs and how they really looked. We didn't learn about the Ottoman Empire. We didn't learn about the Moors. Does anybody know who the Moors were? A lot of people don't because they didn't learn it in high school. But we learned about the Greeks. We learned about the Romans. We learned about the British. But we never were taught about our history. The only thing that we were taught was we were slaves. And after slavery, we went to a Jim Crow era, which lasted another 100 years. And then in 1964, we had the Civil Rights Bill that was passed. Anything else? Nope. That's all we learn about. And so how does that help us as a people? How does that help us grow to be able to walk alongside our brethren that we went to school with, our sisters and brothers that we look at as like I said, look at those guys I played football and baseball and basketball with his family. How am I able to contribute to society if I don't even know who I am? And still don't. I didn't know this stuff until I personally researched it. I had to go out and find it myself. At Beaver Falls, we could take that opportunity because we're placed in that unique situation where we're the color barrier has to be confronted front on. We can take that opportunity and be an example like we are in all those other areas to the rest of not only Beaver County, but to the United States. We have that opportunity. So, let's look at the other flip side. The other flip side is, yes, I've had those experiences, but my organization, I can't call it my organization, our organization is made up of a diverse group of people. We have white people, we have black people, we have social workers, we have teachers, we have former principals, we have businessmen, we have guidance counselors. Everybody's a different walk. And when we're able to combine forces, okay? Think of it as a fist. When you're able to combine those forces, you become something so strong that nothing can get in your way to stop your mission. Nothing. The founding fathers, and I'll call them founding fathers, they were absolutely correct when they say, together we stand, and divided we fall. Here at Beaver Falls, we have found a way to stand together in so many instances. And that's why when I wake up in the morning and I look across the street and I see B&W falling down and I go to work and when I on my way to work I drive past the wave pool and I see the wave pool crumbling, I still know that there's hope and that there's light. And that's why when I moved from Beaver Falls to Texas and then to Johnstown, I made sure that I came back to finish at Beaver Falls. Because Beaver Falls is my home. Beaver Falls shaped me to be the person that I am today. I could not be standing up here giving this great story, being introduced by great people, without Beaver Falls contributing to that. So I'm going to ask you one more time. How has Beaver Falls shaped you thus far? And how will it shape you in your future? And I hope that when you think about that, you have a light that comes on and not a darkness that overshadows your thoughts. Well, with that being said, I want to thank you guys for coming out to listen to what I have to say. So much, guys. I really appreciate it. Really appreciate it.
Proud of you, Rocky.
It's been a real honor to do this. Seriously. This is a question that, like I said, I had to search deep. And it's something that you talk about at the dinner table. It's something that you may talk about with your closest people. But for Wendy to give me that platform, to be able to communicate it to you guys, I'm honor. The pleasure is all mine.
Thank you
very much.
Rocky, thank you for making us look so good. Yeah. Thank you.
Good job, Rocky.
Hey, thank you, Rocky, for sharing with us this evening. What a great job. Thank you for doing that. Hey, I don't have anything else. Thank you very, very much for coming out. Just a reminder, the next two lecture series, in 2 weeks from today, that's March 30th, we've invited Mr. Rick Davis to speak. He's another Beaver Falls native who has who's a successful entrepreneur down in the Atlanta area. So he's coming to town to talk about growing up in Beaver Falls. And then April 13th, so that's in 4 weeks, we're going to have Mrs. Regina Jones, another Beaver Falls native, speak. If you're interested, their biographies are out on the table. You can pick those up if you'd like to read more about them. But otherwise, thank you very, very much for coming out, and hopefully we'll see you in a couple weeks.
Oh, thank you.